Hey guys, David here and welcome to the Fitpro Daily. And first of all, welcome back to a brand new year. I hope you had a great festive period. Everything went well and you also enjoyed the new year. But now it's back to it, okay? Back to getting things done, growing our fitness business, generating the leads that we need. And I thought, why not start this year off with a mega guest interview? We're going to invite Jono on all the way from Australia to share his knowledge and success with Facebook groups. But Jono, awarded 2020 Educator of the Year in Australia, runs the biggest fitness education program in Australia too. As you can guess, just from that alone, is going to be a massive guest. If you are listening to this, maybe on the podcast or you've got the screen off, my recommendation would be to kind of jump onto the video as Jono is going to come on with a load of slides and presentations to show us different stuff. And these are stuff that we probably don't want to miss. And as you can guess, this week is all about Facebook groups. So we're going to start off with Jono today, and then we've got the rest of the stuff covered for this week. But before we do dive into Jono's presentation, if you haven't subscribed to the channel just yet, make sure you do that by clicking that big red button below to subscribe. That way you'll never miss any future episodes. But enough of me talking, let's dive into today's guest interview. Good evening, guys, and welcome to today's Fitpro Lead Gen show. Today we have a special guest, actually, somebody that was voted Australia's top fitness entrepreneur last year, was it, or something, or this year? Fitness Educator of the Year. Wow, yeah, that is some title, and so you must know what you're talking about, I'm guessing, then.
I hope so. Either that or the rest of Australia are just absolute idiots. And I better not, and I hope that's not the case, because I'll get kicked out of my own country.
Very true. Okay, so you're going to come on today and talk about Facebook groups, and we had a quick chat, and you're going to come at us with a presentation of some sort?
Yes, that would be great. I love Facebook groups. I could talk all day about it, so I'll limit it down. Just out of curiosity, how much time have we got, David? Just so I know how
As long as you want. We tend to do it around an hour, however
long. An hour, yes, perfect. Yeah. That's perfect.
And awesome. Just for anybody that's actually listening, I'm guessing some of the slides might be better if you are watching. So if you are listening on the podcast, wherever you tend to watch this type of stuff, definitely head back over to the website or the YouTube channel or the Facebook groups to come back and actually watch the slides that we're going to talk about. But we start every episode off by asking, how did you yourself get into the fitness industry?
Yes, good question. Well, long story short, I started in the boot camp space. I used to run a boot camp. I was at a franchise, actually. And long story short, I used to suck at it, David. I was at this franchise and they had 75 different locations across Australia and New Zealand. And you were ranked based on how good you were. You know, number one meant you had the best retention, best numbers in the franchise. Number 75 meant you have the worst. Now, take a guess what you think I was ranked, David, when I started.
Should we go with 75?
75, bang on. I was dead last, right? And I knew 74. 74 was not a good trainer. So the fact that I was coming 75 wasn't great. But I loved it. You know, I'm like, you know what? I like running boot camps. I like being outside. I like people. I like the model. It was a good model as well, because it was basically run one session a day. And I sort of did the math and I was like, hold on, I'm charging 50, because I was working full time at a gym at the time as well, right? And I did the math and I was like, hold on. $50 a week, all I need is 20 people, and I'm making more money than I am at the gym, working 40 hours, running one boot camp a day. I get 40, imagine if I get 60. So I was like, I want to get good at this. So had a meeting with the franchise owners, because I think they were going to give me the sack for coming 75th. And they were basically like, hey, Jono, we got good news and we got bad news. The bad news is when it comes to running a boot camp, you suck. You're coming 75th. You've seen the pie chart. Yeah. But they were like, the good news, because before that, they were sort of like, hey, what's going on? You know? And I'd come up with every excuse under the sun. You know, it was like, oh, look, it's not my fault. It's all this competition. There's all these 24-hour gyms. There's, you know, a boot camp on every corner. Every second person's a personal trainer. There's Instagram. There's free workouts on YouTube, yada, yada, yada. They were like, hey, you know, at the moment, you're blaming everybody else but yourself. If you just flick the switch, take a bit of responsibility and say, hey, maybe it's not everyone else's fault. maybe it's your fault. You're not good enough at sales. Go and learn sales. You're not good enough at marketing. Go and learn marketing. You're not good enough at running workouts. Go and learn how to run workouts. You're not good enough at go and learn this stuff. Instead of blaming everyone else, learn them. And I was like, okay, you know, that sort of makes sense. And one thing they mentioned was the Facebook group, because every location had your own Facebook group, yada, yada, yada. And mine was dead. Never posted in there, right? Never did anything in there. And they were like, hey, your Facebook group is dead as well. And I'm like, what's that got to do with anything? You know, out of all the problems I've got in the world, you know, having an interactive Facebook group has nothing to do with how good I am as a bootcamp instructor. And they were like, well, you know, we sort of think you does. And I'm like, well, I sort of think it doesn't. And they're like, yeah, well, let's look at it logically, Jono. We've got 75 boot camps. We run all 75. We own all 75. And you're coming 75th. Maybe we know something you don't. And I was like, okay, good point. I might put a bit of effort into this Facebook group stuff. But long story short, I did that stuff. I dedicated, hey, I'm going to do courses on marketing, on sales, hire business coaches, attend other trainers' sessions, learn from the best, mastermind, everything I possibly could study-wise. Long story short, a year later, I went back to the same convention where I was and I was 75th. Now take a guess what I was, David, 12 months later.
10th.
Number one. Number right, 75 to 1. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it sort of lit a fire in me. I'm like, I want to keep learning, want to keep growing. Long story short, built that boot camp to 100 members. Also started up another boot camp location with 50 members. And then I had other trainers start to ask me, hey, how are you doing this boot camp stuff, you know? And I was like, well, it's simple. I'm blah, 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 blah. Then long story short, put a course together, how to run a successful boot camp. Right. That was quite successful. Put another course together, another course, another course, another course, yada, yada, yada. Here we are a few years later. I run Fitness Education Online, which is the largest provider of CEC courses in Australia and New Zealand. I think we've got about 30 different courses. And yeah, was lucky enough to win the 2020 Australian Fitness Educator of the Year. And that's essentially what I do now at Fitness Education Online, online CEC courses or CPD courses, I think they're called in the UK for personal trainers.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's quite a journey then, and it kind of gives inspiration to other bootcamp owners or gym owners or just any Fitpro in general who is struggling. Put the work in, learn, kind of replicate what the people who are successful doing. And it, like you said, 1 year later, you've gone from 75th to first. It really doesn't take that long to get to that point.
That's it. You learn sales, you learn, assuming you're a good at what you do. Right. Yeah. I guess that's the basis. You need to have a good service. But once you've got that, if your service is good, your retention is good, like sales and marketing, it's just learned stuff, you know, anyone can learn it.
So when they were saying about the free groups before we jump into the presentation, were they talking about free groups to invite prospects in, or were they talking about actual members groups, your clients?
That group they were talking about were members groups clients. I'm going to speak a little bit about both today because they are related and there's different strategies and it is very different if you're online versus in person. So I'm going to cover a little bit of both of those today. But just as an overview, my suggestion for everyone listening would be start with your members group. Start with that, master that, because it's going to be easier to get engagement in that. Because one of the major strategies you need in your Facebook group is engagement in there. You can invite every idiot in the world in your group. If no one's posting, no one's commenting, it's worthless, right? Yeah. The real strategy you need is how can I get this group a place of value? So there's people posting, there's people commenting, there's people replying to my stuff. That's ideally what you want, right? Now, if you're doing it in a free group where no one knows you, it's hard work. You know, like if there's one thing that Facebook has taught me, and I'm sure you'll agree, David, you don't want to rely on the kindness of strangers. You know, when it comes to social media, that's probably not one of the things you want to do. It's easier to start with your client group, right? Because they already know you. They already like you. They've already got buy-in. They want to support you. Once you've mastered a few of those strategies there, then you can be like, all right, I get this Facebook group stuff. Now let me start a free group. Let me get people in there. I know how to get groups engaged. I know what content to post, yada, yada, yada. Now I can work on getting these free people into my paid programs.
Yeah, 100%. Okay. Let's dive straight in then.
Dive into it. Awesome. All right, cool. So I just, I put this together at 5 o'clock in the morning, actually, because I'm in Australia and it's 7 o'clock over here. And I went to a boxing session at 6. So I woke up at 5, checked my calendar. I'm like, got a podcast at 7. Oh, shit, better put this this presentation together. So it's 5 a.m. It may not be perfect, but I've put it as a guideline. If anything doesn't make sense, David, just, you know, jump in. Or if there's anything that I don't explain well enough, feel free to ask me questions on it, because it's literally just a set of dot points. So even if you're listening on the podcast, probably better if you're watching the presentation. But even if you're not, it's just literally a set of dot points that I've got here. So, Facebook groups. First thing I recommend doing, am I allowed to give my group a little plug on here, David?
Of course, yeah.
Okay, awesome, cool. So I was going to say, what I recommend doing is joining my Facebook group, the Fitness Education Online Community, for a couple different reasons. Number one, just for a little bit of like, I guess positioning on my end, because you might be thinking, well, why am I going to listen to you, buddy? You know, what? Who are you? Yeah, you're an educator. What the hell has that got to do with a Facebook group? I've actually run the biggest Facebook group in Australia. For fitness in Australia and New Zealand for fitness professionals. I think it's the also one of the biggest in the world, maybe two or three, the Fitness Education Online Community. So feel free to join that, just so you're like, okay, this guy does know how to run a Facebook group. And also it's just a good group for fitness professionals to be in. You can get tips and you can see how I run groups, yada, yada, yada. So I recommend joining that there. If we talk a little bit about why Facebook groups, there's a few different reasons. The first one is mainly community. So there's many different social media platforms out there, and they all work, whether you're running Facebook ads, YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, TikTok, Twitter, whatever it may be. If you know how to do it, it's going to work. But the one strategic advantage that Facebook groups has that I don't think any other platform does nearly as well is the community side of things. So I can create an Instagram account. I can grow my following. That's great. I can do it on any platform. But on a Facebook group, I'm building that community side of things. It's not just about me. It's about community. Okay. So that's the biggest advantage there. And I'll go into some of the advantages about community later. But for now, just think of it like that. That's why you want a Facebook group, for that community aspect. And I'm going to speak about groups in general here, and then we'll get a bit more specific to if it's a community one or if it's a VIP paying one. But either way, if you have a big Facebook group, you've got leverage or positioning over other heavy hitters. Let's just use the most basic example here. Let's say you've got a free Facebook group. Everyone in there are locals in your area. Let's even say it's local mums, for example. You train women only. They're usually mums. You've got a Facebook group of 1,000 local mums in the area. All right. That group now is prime marketing for other heavy hitters in the area. All right. You don't just make it a spam thing where everyone can post anytime, but you strategically can allow other people to promote their services. Let's just use the most basic example again, a physiotherapist. Okay. A new physiotherapist comes into the area. They might check out the local Facebook groups. Where's the buy, swap, and sell? Where's the mums groups? Where's the fitness groups? Yada, yada, yada. They find your group there. They might hit you up. Hey, look, I see you've got a local group. You know, do you mind if I make a post in there and promote my services? Or do you mind if I, you know, if you promote my services in there? Hey, in return, I'll give your clients discounted physiotherapy. I'll give you discounted physiotherapy. I'll send an email out to my list promoting your services there. Right. And it doesn't even need to. I use physio because it's an easy one. Could be the local freaking real estate agent. You know, they've got a new local place they want to rent out. Your group could be prime there for them to do a little promotion post. Now, you want to have rules around that. It's not just a go anytime. But the point I'm trying to make here is if you have a local Facebook group, and even online can work as well, because you're going to have one specific niche, right? But even if we're just speaking about a local Facebook group, if you've got a whole heap of locals in there, that gives you leverage and positioning. You're a person of power. Other local people in the area with lists, they want to approach you. They want to be your friend. They want to suck up to you. They want to help you out. So in return, you can help them out there. Does that point make sense, David?
Yeah, that makes total sense. And it, like you say, it's key, because when someone is looking for a specialist and they see that you are the specialist, your group is for mums, your group's got 500, 600, doesn't you have to be a massive number, as long as we're talking maybe 100 plus, it does make you look like you're much further ahead than you might actually be. Yeah. So that's definitely a valid point, that.
Bang on. It's awesome for cold outreach as well. Now, whether you do this or not, completely up to you. But cold outreach is a good way to meet people, right? You go on LinkedIn, you add the local people in the area. You go on Instagram, you interact the local people in the area. You go in the Facebook groups, you interact with the local people in the area. Now, ideally, you want those people on your list, right? And yeah, you can use lead magnets and things like that. But I find people are very protective of their emails these days. You know, especially if you've just met them, you've sent a few DMs, you're asking for their email, it can come across a little bit cold, right? But what can be an easier way is simply, oh, David, you're a local in the Facebook group as well. Me too. What do you do? Oh, you do that? Awesome. Hey, I actually run a fitness Facebook group in the area. My goal is to have everyone in the group in the area, everyone in the area in the group. Everyone's super supportive. We all share tips and ideas, help each other out. Did you want to join that group? You might be like, meh. Why not? You know, who knows when I'm going to need some fitness tips or when I'm going to need to network with other people in the area. And it's just a lot, it's a gentler approach than me asking for your email. But the first question for you to get into my group is asking for your email anyway. So I'm probably going to get you on my list and I'm going to use different strategies later on. But either that first point is just a way friendlier way to do it. And that's where I see Facebook groups moving forward in the future. You know, like 5 years ago, it was very easy. Hey, you want this free thing? Here's my email. But now people are a lot more protective of emails. There's almost like a step beforehand, which is where the Facebook group can come into play there. And it's a good organic way to build your list. So what I mean by that is if you do everything right, Facebook, two things, or your group will grow organically because Facebook will start showing it to people that have similar interests or in similar groups, like similar things, yada, yada, yada. So you're just going to get Facebook's going to do your marketing for you. I know you're a Facebook ads guy, David. I love Facebook ads myself. The one thing with, and I always recommend doing Facebook ads. The one thing with Facebook ads, you got to put dollars behind it. Yes, you want to make money back, of course. But why not, as you've got your Facebook ads going, also get some organic people in this group as well. You know, if you're doing everything right, Facebook is going to show it to those people. They're going to join that group. And it works very well with email marketing because there's pros and cons in both. I'm also a big email marketing guy. David, you're big on email marketing as well, right?
Yep. Every day.
Yep. Awesome. Cool. Me too. So the reason why I find they work well together is email is usually a bit more written based. Usually you write an email, right? Facebook group is usually more video based, especially in the fitness space as well. So they sort of work well together where you can share that same message, but one of them is a bit more written, one of them is a bit more video. Also, there's just slight differences between the two. There's advantages that email has over Facebook as well, and I'll get to some of them later, but the biggest advantage that a Facebook group has is that someone's less likely to unsubscribe, for lack of a better word, right? I might opt into David's list, a few emails in, I might just be like, I'm getting two emails from everyone. I'm just going to do a cleanup and unsubscribe from everyone, right? A lot of people will do that. Everyone that does email marketing gets unsubscribed. It's part of life, right? But Facebook group, it's usually a bit more of an effort to leave. You know, even if I don't really like David's group, I'm going to stay in there just in case. You know, and I don't even know how to leave a group, to be honest. It's probably more of a, I've got to find the settings and find the button and confirm. It's just so much effort to leave that group. So they can work quite well together. Someone may unsubscribe from your email list. All good. They're still in your Facebook group. You do a good promo, whatever it may be. They get back on your email list later for free. So there's some of the reasons why. Do all them make sense? That's all pretty clear, David?
Yeah, that all makes sense. And like you say, the Facebook group, and you'll probably go into it a bit more in a minute, but it's like an incubator. You're putting people in there to build that trust and value. So like you say, the free group, once you've built enough trust and value and put an offer out there, whether it's just the ebook offer to get them back on the email list or to actually offer them a service or a hook to get them involved, then you've built enough credits with them for them to eventually reach out and want to go for it. Yeah.
Bang on. Awesome. All right. So I'm going to simplify it. There's basically three types of groups. There's the community, there's the free group, the free community group. That's one group, right? Everyone knows what that is. That's the free group. There's the VIP group, which is just for your paying clients. And there's also the test group. If you take nothing else out of this presentation, put together a test group with just you in there. You may need to add one other person, but you can kick them out later anyway, and just practice stuff. That test group has saved me so much dramas over the years. You know, you want to just test what your lighting looks like, your sound looks like, your post looks like. You know, what does it look, how much rows come up, does it work in a group, what does the live look like? So if you take nothing else out of this, at least put together a test group and practice it there. But I want to speak a little bit about community and VIP, because they are very different and there's different people that are going to teach you different things. I'll give you the spin on both, like everyone's philosophies, and then I'll share mine. So your community group is basically a lead generation. That's basically why you've got it. Yeah, you do things to build trust, but it's basically to get people in there, build trust, sell them. That's why you do it, right? The disadvantage to having a free community group, if that's all you've got, you've just got one Facebook group, it's a free community group, it cheapens your VIP group a bit, right? Because if you've got a group just for paying members and that group is awesome, that can often be enough to keep people in there. And I've had clients before that are like, hey, Jono, I can't make boot camp for the next 4 weeks, but I love your Facebook group. I love what you're doing there. I love the support. Can I keep paying you full price just to stay in the Facebook group? Right? If I had a free group, it wouldn't quite work like that. Okay. And I'll share some solutions in a sec, but just for now, the advantage of the community group is it allows you to build your list, make sales. The disadvantage is it cheapens your VIP group a bit. The VIP group sucks for lead gen, right? Because if you've just got a VIP group and that's all you've got, well, you know, you can't really use it as a lead gen thing because it's only your paying clients going in there. But the advantage to it is it adds awesome value to your program. People will pay you just to be part of your Facebook group if you're doing it properly, okay? Now, I recommend in the fitness space, we ideally need two of them, especially if you're doing face-to-face. You need your VIP one for your paying clients, and then you need your community one for the as a lead generation side of things. If you've got an online business, it's not that important to have both, okay? If you've got an online business, depending on what your business is, but let's say, for example, for my online course business, right? I'm better off just having one because I want everyone in that Facebook group, just that one free group, because the paid content is on like the other side anyway. You know, and I don't really need to use that group as a value add for that side of things there. So if you're in the online world, you can get away with just having one. And that's easier because it's less work. The more groups, the more work, right? But in the fitness space, you probably need to have two. You have your VIP for your paying clients and your community for your lead gen. If you're just starting off with the Facebook groups, start with your VIP. I touched on it earlier. Start with that because there's going to be more engaged people in there. So start with that, master that. Once you've got that mastered, then get your community group. Don't do them both at the same time because it can get super confusing. Oh, what do I post in this one? What do I post in that one? Who goes in this one? Who goes in that one? So start with the VIP, get a really good handle on that, then open up your community one there. Okay. Does that make sense, the difference between the two, David?
Yeah. And I think you made a valid point about that community aspect. If you are an online trainer and you are selling just products, rather than a group service, then having that community group where people are coming in, you're telling them when product launches are, and people are getting excited, and people are letting other people know that they've just bought your program and it's wicked, they love using it. They're selling your services or products for you to the other members of the group. So having that free community group definitely help for a product-based online training.
Bang on, yes. Okay. Now let's talk a little bit about the VIP because it's easier to get engagement in there. Your goal is to get it like a really close space, a tight community. Now there's a few strategies. So if you've got a group at the moment with your paying members, there's a few strategies that I recommend that can just get a heap of engagement straight away if done properly. The easiest one to start with, this is more a bootcamp side of things, but it can sort of work with anything as well, which is essentially at the start of, I'll share how I do it and how I recommend doing it, is every Sunday, you make a post in your Facebook group, you pin it up the top, you essentially say, hey, here's this week's schedule, comment below and let me know what days you're attending so I can plan for it. Okay. And then I'll send that out in a text message or via email, basically say, hey guys, look, the schedule for the week is up. Let me know what sessions you're attending so I can plan for it. All right. I don't care who attends any sessions. It's a boot camp, right? I plan for big numbers. I plan so I can, you know, run the session no matter who it is. All I'm doing here is just almost forcing engagement in that group. Because if I've got someone that every single week is posting in that group there, that's going to help, or commenting on my post there, that's going to help my group engagement. Because Facebook is like, okay, hold on, you know, every time this guy posts, there's every single person in the group comments. These people must want to see what's in this group. Whenever someone posts in that group, let's show everyone in that group what's in that group there, right? So it helps the algorithm side of things. But even just from a user perspective side of things, if you've just started a boot camp, I'm going to use boot camp as the basic, because that's usually that's my background, but you can replace the word bootcamp with whatever you do, online program, personal training, gym, whatever it is, right? So someone joins any of those programs straight away, the last thing they're going to do is post on Facebook, right? They're probably a bit in your group. They're probably, oh, do I fit in here? There's all those things going on. But this just gives them the easiest way, the easiest first thing in, where it's like, oh, okay, well, I've got to let this guy know what sessions I'm going to so I can plan for it. So I better post in there. And then after they've posted a few times, oh, you know what? This group isn't too bad. I can go in this group and I can post, and they're going to be more likely to post later. This is the biggest mistake I see with most Facebook group owners, is they're like, ah, no one's posting in my group. You know, I ask them questions, but no one replies, and, you know, no one's posting or no one's replying to other people's things. It's like anything. You've got to sort of ease them into it. And that is the easiest way to ease people into it. Just comment what sessions you're attending below this post here, because your clients ideally think they have to, right? And no matter what you're doing, even if you're running, you know, an online program, hey, comment below and let me know what day is your training today so I can keep you accountable. You know, you're running a studio. Hey, comment, let me know what day is your training today so I can keep you accountable. Whatever it may be, that you're running a personal training thing. Hey, just by you typing what days you're coming in, you're going to be more likely to actually attend and not cancel. So type what days you're coming in there. All right. That's the easiest first step for anyone. And I recommend everyone do something like that to get the ball rolling. Okay. The next best thing you can do is challenges. Now, this is why. So going back to when I've had members before that have said, you know, hey, John, I want to stay in your boot camp, even though I'm not, can't make the sessions, is mainly because of the challenges I do. Even when I run a boot camp, I'm basically running an online program as well. It's basically the two of them there. I run a boot camp, and at the same time, I'm running an online program. It's just, if you sign up for the physical sessions, you get the online stuff for free. Okay. Now there's many different challenges out there, and I'm just going to simplify them. I'm going to state the ones that work best, because I've tried heaps and some work, heaps of them fail as well. So I'm just going to share the ones that work. These are ones that have worked for me. I'm going to share some tips and strategies on how they can work for you as well. Now, even though I'm talking about the VIP group here, this stuff can also work in the community group as well. I'm just starting with the VIP because it's easier to get this rolling with a VIP. Then once you've got these challenges rolling in your VIP, then you can start to get them in your community as well. All right. So probably my favorite challenge is the get to know you challenge. The way this one simply works is you just tell people, hey, you know what I want you to do. Everyone, here's everyone's, let's say it's a boot camp. Hey guys, it's week one of our challenge. Your task for this week is you need to post a photo of yourself in the Facebook group, and you need to post 3 facts about yourself, but one of them is a lie. And everyone else, you need to guess what that lie is for that person there. Okay. Now, it might sound like a silly game, but there's a few things going on. Firstly, it's fun, you know, it's fun. It's not just a boring, hey, you know, and there are some boring ones later, but they can work as well. Like, let's say, hey, track how much sugar you have. That's a good challenge, but it's pretty boring, you know, coming up with something which is like, hey, post a photo, 3 things, one of them has to be false. Everyone likes talking about themselves, so it gives them a chance to sort of show off a little bit there as well. But the kicker on this is saying one has to be wrong. Everyone else, guess which one is wrong, right? The reason that works is similar, and you'll see a common thread with everything that what I do, is my whole goal of a Facebook group is not for me to post. It's not for me to post. That's not what a Facebook group is for. I can do that on my personal profile. I can do that on Instagram, right? Don't get me wrong. I do a little bit of that on my Facebook group as well. But the advantage of the Facebook group that we touched on earlier, I want other people posting and I want other people commenting on that post there. Right? That's the value of a community. If that person posts and I'm the post a question or whatever, and I'm the only person answering, it's not a valuable community. right? They could have just DM'd me that. It's probably not bad because, okay, maybe some other people see that question as well. They might have had the same one. But really what you want is someone to post and they get a whole heap of different responses from other people here, right? What I'm doing here is forcing my members to make a comment on someone else's post, right? See how the first little challenge there was comment what sessions you're doing. That's just to get used to people commenting to my post. Now what I'm doing here is almost forcing people to comment on other people's posts. Now they're getting used to this. Oh, I can post on other people's posts. Oh, this isn't too bad. Oh, this is a community, yada, yada, yada. Does that make sense there, David?
Yeah. Like you say, people are starting to build that friendship and community themselves then because they're interacting with each other online.
Bang on it. Exactly. And if it's a face-to-face thing, oh, hey, David, I didn't know you played golf. You were a junior golf champion. I love playing golf. You know, what's your favorite course you play at or whatever it may be? You know,
that same sort of thing. That is a lie.
Yeah. Well, you suck at golf?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There we go. That was the lie there. But you know what I mean? It's just a way to connect with people there. Now, the no sugar and the walking challenge, these ones work really well as well. The way this essentially works is it's like, hey guys, look, for 14 days or 7 days, whatever it is you want to choose, we're going to track how much grams of sugar you have. Everyone download MyFitnessPal. I'm going to make a post here. Here's the no sugar thread. You're going to comment your name down below, and then you reply to your comment each day saying how much grams of sugar you had. Monday, 6, Tuesday, 7, Wednesday, 40, whatever it may be, right? And then you can do the same thing with walking. Hey, you know, a few weeks later, we're going to do the walking challenge, you know, go and download the Nike app or use your iPhone, whatever it may be, you know, track how much kilometers you do right at each day. Now, there's a few things going on here. What you're doing here is just getting people to check every day because now they're going, and there's multiple benefits here. This is no longer just an engagement thing. Now, this is actually a health benefit, right? And this works well in any challenge you're doing because if anyone gives up any sort of weight loss challenge, because if anyone gives up sugar for 2 weeks, they're losing weight. I have not had one person ever do the no sugar challenge for 14 days and not lose weight, right? So it's great for weight loss, great for health, also good for engagement because they're going in there and they're checking every day. And it's almost like habit stacking here. It's like, oh, yep, great. You know, I'll go on Sunday and type what sessions I'm going in. Oh, what's the challenge this week? It's the no sugar challenge. You know, I'll go and, you know, now I've got to go in every day and sort of track it there. These two things here, especially the no sugar one, or both of them work well in your community group as well. Because now what's happening is you've got a post that just let's say you've got 100 people in your community Facebook group, right? You do the no sugar challenge and let's say, I don't know, 10 people say they want to do it. You've now got 10 people every single day going and commenting on that post there. Everyone in your group is going to see that post now because there's just so much people liking and commenting on it, right? That's also it's also a good lead builder. And it's also a good sales process as well. And this even works really well online. This is one of the best ones you can do online, right? You've got a free Facebook group. You do your no sugar challenge. Great. Enter your details down here to go into the, you know, to participate in the challenge, yada, yada, yada. You run it in the group there. By the end of the 2 weeks, your sell is essentially, hey, you know, and you obviously survey halfway through, whatever it may be. You do the sales pitch in the end, which is essentially, hey, did you enjoy it? Yes. Did you get results? Yes. Hey, I've actually got an online program, which includes this sort of stuff, plus the exercise stuff as well. Are you interested in that? They're like, well, shit, I've already got results just from the diet side of things. Imagine what I do if I do the exercise as well. Yeah, man, sign me up for that. All right? Does that make sense?
Mate, totally. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. Other things like recipe or smoothie challenge, you know, hey, make sure the challenge for this week is everyone needs to post a recipe. All right? And this works well many different ways as well, both the recipe and the smoothie. Firstly, just for engagement and fun and all that sort of stuff there. But my kicker for this is if I'm running any sort of program, right? I'm like, all right, what everyone's going to do is put together at least one healthy recipe, post it in the group with a photo. I'm going to collate all the recipes. I'm going to then put them together as an ebook. And then everyone in this group is going to get a copy of that ebook that you can take home and do whatever you want with it, right? You do the same thing with smoothies as well. And now you've got assets too. You don't have to go out and create a clean eating recipe ebook. You don't need to go out and create a clean eating smoothie and shake ebook. You've already got a clean eating recipe ebook and a clean eating smoothie and shake ebook that your clients have put together for you. And if you do this every 12 weeks, you can either have do it a few different ways. You can have a massive ebook that's just got years and years worth of recipes and smoothies, or you can vary it up, right? 12 weeks, hey, just share your favorite breakfast. The next 12 weeks later, share your favorite lunch. The next one later, your favorite snacks. The next one later, your favorite dinners or desserts, whatever it may be. So now you're stacking your ebooks. Hey, sign up for my bootcamp or sign up for my online program. Not only do you get the sessions, you also get my clean eating dinners ebook. You also get my, you know, my clean eating lunches. You get my, clean eating snacks, yada, yada, yada. You're stacking up your own assets and you haven't done any work putting any of that together. Make sense?
Yeah, totally.
Cool. Then you've got like the team challenge. I'll get to the second. So, you know, the team challenges, like, hey, you know, as a team, we need to get through 20 minutes of planks every single day, right? You only get one shot. And what you need to do, here's my thread once again, you know, here's the planking thread or the squat holding thread, whatever it may be. Let's use plank as an example. What you need to do is hold a plank for as long as you can today, and then put your phone, your timer on your phone, screenshot that, and then post it under this post here, all right? I'm going to add up all the numbers. If you can only do 30 seconds, great, do 30 seconds. You know, someone does 2 minutes, you do 2 minutes. Great, whatever it may be. But by the end of the day, by 11:59 p.m. tonight, if there's 20 minutes of planks, here's your prize. If there's less, here's your punishment, okay? So it's like a team sort of thing. And there's a few things here. Firstly, there's the punishment and the prizes, right? So let's say, for example, the Get to Know You challenge. It could be something along the lines of like, you know, hey, here's what you got to do. You post a photo of yourself. You comment on everyone else's, yada, yada, yada. And hey, by the way, if you do it, great. If you don't do it by the end of the week, you need to do 20 burpees at the end of boot camp. So make sure you do it, you know? Or the, say, for example, the recipe sharing challenge. Hey, I've connected with a local nutritionist. They're going to give one person in this group a free nutrition session, okay? To go into the draw, you need to post one of these recipes. If you don't post a recipe, you don't go into the draw, right? The plank I touched on earlier there, you know, hey, if you reach your target by the end of the session, I need to do 20 burpees as the trainer. You know, if I don't, you got to do 20 burpees, right? And I'm just using burpees as an example. It can be whatever you want. What I want you to get thinking here, all the listeners, is like, okay, what can I, for every little challenge I do, how can I get buy-in? Because there's always going to be challenges where you post and like, no one does it, you know? So what can you do to get more buy-in? What are some prizes you can throw in there that ideally don't cost you time and money that you can give people for participating? And then what are some punishments you can give? Fun things. You don't want to turn anyone off, but what are some sort of fun punishments we can give? You know, is it, hey, if you don't do this, you got to dance like Beyonce in tomorrow's session and I'm going to do it on Facebook Live or whatever it may be, you know? Think of those different punishment and prizes. And also, if you haven't done a lot of this stuff, you really need to actively promote it at the start until it becomes culture. Like anything, let's say you're at a gym and there's a bad gym culture where people don't put their weights away, right? One announcement over the PA is not going to fix that culture. It's going to take speaking to every single person individually, a few emails, a few texts, a few things. Like that's what it takes to change culture. Same sort of thing here, right? So if you've done challenges before and you're like, oh, I've done challenges that don't work, there's a few things. Firstly, make sure your challenges are actually good, that things that people want to participate in. If they don't want to participate in, they're not going to do it. So make sure your challenges are good. On top of that, make sure you have some sort of punishment and prizes, make it juicy. And then thirdly, actively promote it, you know, do it via email, text, individual, DM, group, especially individually. When starting off, individually works the best. It's going to take longer, but that's what you need to do to change culture. Right. And let's talk about a VIP group here as an example. Let's say you've got a boot camp and you've got, I don't know, 50 people in that boot camp. It's not that hard to say, all right, right, I'm doing this challenge next week. Every day I'm going to DM 10 people or text 10 people and just say, hey, I'm doing this challenge. Have you heard of it? After you've done that a few times, it becomes culture. People want to participate. You don't need to keep doing it. Okay. But at the start, you need, like anything in life, right? You need to put more effort at the start. Once it's rolling at the start, it becomes easier as we go on. Does that slide all make sense there?
Yeah, all good, I think. And like I say, anybody that's obviously watching it, they can just press pause, rewind, take some screenshots, take some notes, and then move forward with the presentation. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. And I've got these under VIP, but all these work in community as well, right? They work amazing in community. And they're all really good ways to build community, to build leads, to make sales as well in your community group here. It's just easier to do it the first time in your VIP group. Make sure you've got it right. Then you do it in your community group. And you can do it in both. You know, 1 week you do it in your VIP. Great. You know, the next month you do that exact same challenge in your community because it's different people in there. They won't even know that you did it in your VIP group. Okay. Now, let's talk specifically about the community group now. So now let's speak to the people that are like, right, I've got a VIP group. That's happening. That's pumping. Now I want this community one to get new people in there, to use it as a lead gen. You know, how do I do that? Well, there's a few things I recommend. Firstly, don't start your community group until you've got a bunch of people to add in immediately. Because I've seen this over and over again, especially with a lot of trainers that sort of follow me. They're like, oh, Jono, you've got this big Facebook group. I want to do the same thing. I'm going to start one up. But if you've got no one to put in there, it's boring and there's no value. Like the value is in the community, you know? So if you start a group and you've got 5-10 people in there, there's almost no point. There's not going to be any interaction. You're not going to enjoy it. You're going to get bored. You're going to give up. And then it's very, very hard to re-engage. You can do it, but it's hard to re-engage a dead Facebook group. Right? Because a lot of people think with the community side of things, they're sort of like, oh, once I get, you know, more people in there, then it'll get more engaging. There's an element of that that's truth. But to start with, you want like a bunch of people to add in. And a bunch is relative, right? And also not everyone who you've got will want to join the group or whatever. But for now, just have a think of it. Think, all right, if I want to start a community group, do I have at least 20 people that I know will get in there? Because even, and here's the other thing as well, even if you think you've got 20 people that you can add in off the start, like only half of them might join. So you might need to have 40 people that you think want to join to get 20 people in there. All right. But anyway, this is all sort of relative, but that's what I want you to think. Don't just start a Facebook group and think that Facebook is going to automatically start showing it to people, right? Or that people are just going to want to be in this Facebook group, even though there's no one in there and there's no community and there's no engagement. They won't, right? So let's have a, when you're thinking of starting up a Facebook group, be like, all right, right, let me find a way to build my list so I can get people in this group here. Maybe you already have an email list. Maybe you've got a couple hundred people on your email list. Great. They can be the first people in your Facebook group, right? Or it might be time to go out and network, you know, go out and meet some people, go on Instagram, go on LinkedIn, whatever it may be, go and do some networking. Don't invite them to your group straight away, but you keep a list of people. And you're like, right, this month I've spoken to 100 people that are in this local area here or that are in my local niche. Cool. I'm going to start up a Facebook group next month and I'm going to invite all of these 100 people. I know at least 50 of them are going to start. Cool. Now I've got the ball rolling, right? And also, especially at the start, because what you want to do when you start a Facebook group community one is get people posting and introducing themselves. You know, hey, just accepted you into the group. David, you know, make sure you do a post and introduce yourself and say what you do. Right. So that way, you know, as people, when you start the group, you've now just got a whole heap of people posting in there, introducing themselves, saying what you do, people networking, connecting, yada, yada, yada. And then as newer people start to join in, there's already a heap of content in there. They join that group and they're like, oh, what's this? There's already a whole heap of people posting and introducing themselves. That's what I must do in this group. I'm going to go in this group and make a post and introduce myself, right? Same sort of thing, where at the start, it's a bit of work, but if you get that culture going, it just happens and happens and happens, right? The other thing you need is a system to keep adding people in, because it's great. You got whatever it is, 50 people in the group to start with. That's great. You're going to get traction for, you know, a couple of weeks, maybe a month. But if you don't add people in, it's just going to be the same conversations happening. People are going to get bored. It's like the old popcorn strategy. You know, let's say you've got a big pot of popcorn or whatever it may be. And let's say it's warm to start with. It's really warm in there, right? But if you just let it sit in there and you don't add any new warm popcorn, that popcorn is going to become cold, right? But if you take some of that cold popcorn out and that warm, put some new warm popcorn in down the bottom, it's always going to be warm. It's the same sort of thing with Facebook groups and systems to add people in. I'm going to show you a few in a second, but now just think of it like that. Be like, great, I need to build up a few people so when I launch, I've got a heap of people I can add in there, but I need to have something in place so that every week or every day, I'm finding a few people that I can use to join this group here, okay? And then you need to understand engagement, but I'm assuming that you've got this because you've already mastered it in your Facebook group. So really, it's just the first two. Once you understand engagement, make sure you've got a whole heap of people you can add in straight away and make sure you've got a system to keep adding people in this group here, okay? And I touched on this earlier. So what I mean by engagement is other people posting, right? That's really what I want. I want other people posting in my group. I want them to feel safe. So they post in the group and they know that if they make a post, they're going to get a heap of people commenting on their post and giving them suggestions. That's what I want in a Facebook group. Third is then me. Then it's me posting and people commenting on mine. But that's almost a bonus, right? And that's how I can tell a good Facebook group. If I go in a Facebook group and it's just the owner of that group posting all the time, there's only so much value or community in that group. But if I go in that group and it's more other people posting than the owner, that's a good group. And then it's also how many people are commenting on that person's post there. That's what we want there. Okay. That makes sense community-wise, David?
Yeah, makes all sense again.
Awesome. Now, naming. Now, this is one of these things where, like, I don't want it to slow you down if you're just starting a Facebook group, but naming can be one of the most important parts of your Facebook group for a few different reasons. Firstly, people search on Facebook, especially the local groups, right? I'm in all my local groups just because I want to see what's going on, you know? So there's going to be people that search these things, you know, oh, what's Cogra Mums or, you know, your suburb fitness, your suburb community, your suburb buy, swap and sell, whatever it may be, you know, people are actively searching those things there. So if your name is good, relevant, people are going to find it. Same thing if you run an online business, you want to have your niche's name in that Facebook group, right? If you run a group for personal trainers, you want to have personal trainers in that group because people are going to search it. Now, you can't, like, I don't recommend naming your community group your business name. I did it with Fitness Education Online and it's a mistake. I wish I didn't do it. I mean, there's some advantage that I'm getting a bit of a name for that business there. But in terms of just growing, most personal trainers won't search that to join the group. They might search personal trainers groups, fitness trainers groups, bootcamp instructors groups. I won't be found, right? And that's a mistake. I'm not going to change the name now because it's got a bit of value there. But for anyone having a new group, just think about that there. And also it will pop up in suggested groups. So if your name is clear, it says exactly what your group is here, who it's for. It's going to grow organically because people will type that in the search bar and find it. And also it's going to pop up in suggested groups. And if the name catches people's attention because it speaks to them, they're going to join it. All right. So if your name is good, your Facebook group will grow. It's that simple. There's nothing else. There's obviously other things you can do to grow it. But if you just have the best name, your Facebook group will grow. So get the best name. And there's a few sort of formulas that work really well here. There's like the who community. So what I mean by that, I've just used local examples here. I live in a suburb called Cogra. Cogra Fitness Community, Cogra CrossFit Tribe, right? Anything like that. Even if you run a niche-based, you know, business, this is the busy mums community, you know, the entrepreneurial women community, you know, the kill the dad bod community, you know, whatever it may be. You want that, so like someone can look at it. And if we go back to personal trainers, you know, personal trainers united, you know, the CrossFit movement, you know, the bootcamp association group, you know, anything where you're just calling out your person directly with some sort of word like community or tribe or movement, or, you know, Google synonyms for community and you'll find a heap of different words that work there, but calling them out. Or the what for who can work well as well, you know, fitness tips for Cogra mums. Exercise tips for older adults in Cogra, you know, or even if you run an online business, exercise tips for older adults, you know, fitness tips for busy mums, you know, whatever it may be, the either the who community or the what for who, those usually work quite well in the naming side of things. All make sense there, David?
Yeah, and that was one of the biggest things we had to do with my own fitness business. So we did call it DK9 community, but like no one's going to be ever searching for that unless it's our members. So we obviously did change it, and it was the location, the age and health and fitness. So it's called Cardiff over 30s health and fitness community. So exactly. It literally tells them exactly, like you say, who it is, who this group is for. Yeah.
Bang on. Exactly. Okay. So engagement tips. So we've spoken about challenges already. That's probably your best weapon. You want the person to make the welcome post. So I like to do this via DM. I actually get my virtual assistant to do it. You know, someone joins the Facebook group, my virtual assistant sends them a DM. Hey, you know, just accepted you. Welcome to the group. Feel free to make a post and introduce yourself. All right. So that way, as soon as someone joins the group, they make a post in there. They're more likely to be, you know, engaged in the group. That's going to help with the algorithm. More people are going to see it. More people are going to be encouraged to post, network, yada, yada, yada. Any question, I put it directly to my group. Okay. And this is both a community and a VIP. Like if someone sends me a text message, they're like, hey, Jono, I've got this question. What's your opinion on that? I'll reply with, hey, David, awesome question. I've got the perfect answer for that. Hey, can you do me a favor? Can you post that in the Facebook group? Because I'd love for everyone else to see that answer as well. Right. So what I'm doing there, because if I just replied to that person, there's a few things. If I just replied to that person then and there, the group isn't getting the benefit. Right. But if that person posts in the group, that's going to help everyone in the group, because there's probably heaps of people that have the exact same question as that. Right. And I'm also sort of training my friends and my clients and my leads and whatever, just to post in that Facebook group. If they've ever got a question, they post it in that Facebook group. I think that's the best weapon as well. Anything you get, an email, a phone call, a talk after training, a text message, a Facebook DM, an Instagram DM, you know, hey, awesome question. Do you mind posting in the Facebook group? I got the perfect answer, but I want everyone else to see it as well. If you just do that, your engagement will go through the roof there. And also it's a good time management strategy, because you just need to check that group once a day or whatever it may be and answer the questions there. Sorry.
Yeah, I think that's a key point as well, because if you're telling them to post, anybody else that's thinking that they should be posting as well, or they've just been a little bit too scared to post, it shows that, oh, if this guy posts, then maybe if I post, I'll get my question answered as well.
Exactly. And it's also like, because the people, like, let's say someone did that. Let's say David's a client. He sends me a text. Hey, John, I've got this question. And I'm like, David, that's awesome. Can you post it in the group? The rest of the group don't know that I texted David and said, can you post in that group? They just see, oh, this is a group where people post and people answer. Great. I'm going to do more of that. You can have plants as well. What I mean by plants is you might have certain friends that you're like, hey, once a week, can you just go and post in the group to, you know, and can you just go and answer questions or whatever it may be, for that same reason. They don't know they're your friends. You know, it's just a way to, and also it's value as well, because you make sure that plant asks a good question that is valuable for everyone, because questions are valuable, right? I think questions are probably the most valuable thing you can have in a Facebook group. You giving tips, yeah, that's one way of giving value, but someone asking questions and getting, seeing people's responses to those questions and getting different opinions, that's, I think, the best value in a group. And if you go to any group as well, right, to have a look at them and be like, okay, if someone's posting a tip trying to give value, look how much engagement they get. If someone posts posts and asks a question, look how much engagement they get. And I guarantee you the question will win every time. Right. And that question will probably get more comments like, oh, that's awesome. I never knew that. Oh, love this thread. What a good thread. What a good question. So questions are probably the most valuable thing you can have in a Facebook group. Okay. So let's talk about growth here. I want to be sensitive of your time. How much more time? You're good if we go for another, say, 10 minutes, David?
Yeah. It is 5 to 9 p.m. here in Wales.
What's your bedtime?
Probably 8, so we're well gone.
Okay, I'll race through this stuff, and just if you see anything that you want me to touch a bit more on, just let me know. So if you literally just do this, if you just have a good name and you have good engagement in your group will grow organically. Okay, you got a good name because people are going to find that it's going to pop up. You've got engagement. Facebook will show it to people. It's going to grow. The other thing you can do is stack it with people that are in similar groups. So if it's a face-to-face group, you know, you want everyone that's in the local mums group, the local buy, swap and sell group, the local everything in this group, you want those people in your group because Facebook does the connection and they're like, okay, these are all similar people. Let's show it to these people here. Same thing if you've got a niche, right? You help triathletes, whatever it is, right? Anyone that's in the other triathlete groups, you want them in your group as well because Facebook will then show it to those people there. But really, you're limited by your creativity. You just go out and meet people, right? You're going to, I just remembered I've got a meeting at 8. So I've got to rattle this up in 4 minutes. So, you know, go out and meet people, all right? Your personal Facebook funnel. If you optimize your personal Facebook profile, right, and you've got your group in there, if you go and interact with people on Facebook, they're going to see where your group is. I'll share my screen if we've got a second there and I'll show you mine. Interact in local groups. You could do bring a friend competitions. You know, hey guys, I'm gonna give away a free week of training for everyone to go into the draw. All you need to do is invite three friends into this group. All right, so you can use your group members to grow there. Facebook ads. I never run an ad directly for a group, but I'll have it on the thank you page. So I'll run a Facebook lead ad, you know, hey, here's what it is, enter your details, the thank you page. Hey, by the way, got this community group, heaps of people in there, click here to join, right? So that way your every ad you run, you're also growing your Facebook group as well. Email, you want to sort of cross-pollinate them, you know, you send out an email every now and then, hey, are you in the Facebook group? One of your tips might be like, hey, I made a post in the Facebook group, click here to check it out. It might be in your signature, you know, you're limited by your creativity there. Ex-clients, you know, take them out of your VIP group, put them in your community group. You do your outreach on Instagram, LinkedIn, you got a YouTube channel, you got a podcast, whatever it is. Like my Facebook group is my first point of call because I know once they're in my Facebook group, I'm going to get their email anyway, right? Collaborations work well as well, whether you're doing, share for shares or you're getting people in to be guest speakers and they're telling their audience, hey, join this group to hear my speech, whatever it may be, you know. Leads, your number one way, right, is that question when people join. Make sure one of those questions is something like, hey, would you like a free? Insert your best free lead magnet. If so, drop your email down below, okay? And the better your lead magnet is, the more people that are going to leave it, but you want to have that option there. You want to have a welcome members post as well. So every week you do a post, hey, welcome to all the new members. If you didn't get your freebie when you joined, make sure you click here to get it. Okay, because not everyone's going to give you their email straight away, but if they've been in the group for a week or so, then maybe they will. And then always be lead genning, you know, whatever you're doing in there, giving out you're running your challenges, your free eBooks, your bring a friend weeks, your, you know, new programs, whatever it may be, just always be lead genning because someone might not put their question in to join the group, they might not do the welcome members post, but you might be able to get a lead gen later on as well. Okay, sales, similar sort of philosophy to your email marketing. It's very similar, selling via email as it is in a Facebook group. In saying that, the Facebook group is usually easier to sell less expensive items. So if you're sort of selling anything under $100, it's much of a muchness whether you're selling on email or Facebook. Anything over about $100, I do find it a little bit harder to sell directly via Facebook group. Okay, they'll usually, you might have to do a sales call or a free trial or a bit more work in the DM or sending an email or that sort of stuff there. That's my experience. The lower ticket stuff, a lot easier to sell in Facebook groups. Higher ticket, a little bit harder there. That's pretty much all I wanted to get through, David. I just sort of raced through that end bit because I know we're a bit short on time. Anything else you want me to cover in the next sort of 2 minutes or so?
Have you got any final tips to anybody maybe thinking of really utilizing their groups? I know we covered quite a lot in that hour of kind of flown by on different tips and tricks. I've got a notepad full of info here, but is any final words of wisdom on being super successful with groups?
I would say, let me get a book because I'm a huge book guy and I'll just give a book recommendation. So that way my last tip can give you a 5 hours of reading, you know, what's this? Membership Economy. Okay. So there's a book, Membership Economy. I recommend reading that book there. It doesn't talk specifically about Facebook groups. It just talks about like the new world that we're living in with memberships. And it talks about all, you know, Netflix, Spotify, you know, And just sort of says, like, here's how groups used to be. You used to go to your local church groups, used to go to your local whatever, socialize. They used to, you know, before COVID and before the internet, used to actually socialize in person, right? People have always wanted that sort. There's always been communities where you go to hang out of, and now it's shifted online, but a lot of the principles are still the same. And this book talks about those principles there. So I recommend, yeah, reading that book there. That'll help you free Facebook groups, paid Facebook groups, any community you run.
Perfect. So there you go. That was John, and what an interview it was. Yeah, I know we kind of did talk for a while, and those presentation slides were also quite interesting for you to take plenty of notes on. So if you were actually just listening to it, my recommendation would definitely be to go back, come watch it, take the notes, check out the slides and notes that he was talking about. But that was a great introduction to what we're going to talk about this week, which is creating your free Facebook group or your incubator group to be able to warm these leads up, ready for you to be able to make sales and bring fresh clients in whenever you need. If you enjoyed today's episode, do let us know in the comments below. And if you haven't already subscribed to the channel just yet, make sure you do that by clicking that big red button below. But for now, I'm going to leave you be. I'll speak to you all tomorrow. Cheers.